TikTok look. That is why you get people following you. The gorgeous
I just had to be like, it's time to get to a little
I don't want you touching me.
Now because we got some people in the other room. Not that we want anybody to leave here, but the other room we have Yolang Prue talking about something really important.
No words.
Okay, good. And Sue Fuller Good will be speaking as well. But in this room we have Brendan Innick from Namibia who's going to be talking to us about accelerating your speaker business without saying a word. Again, no words.
No, I'll be speaking.
You'll be speaking. All right, great. All right, so can we please give a warm welcome to Brendan.
I'm not proficient enough to be silent for 45 minutes. That would be a skill that I would have to work very hard at. I am, you know, after such a great lunch, one of the hardest things is for me is to realize that I don't want to speak in anybody's sleep. So I'm going to try extremely hard not to do that. But if you have to catch a quick wink or two, that's completely fine. It's totally understandable. So I want to put this question out to you. Can you accelerate your speaking business as a speaker without saying a word? For a lot of people who will look at us as speakers, regardless of how long in the path you're on, whether you're just starting off in your career, and see most of you here are well seasoned, is that for people that look at us as speakers, it's what we do on stage. That's our business. That's what we do. And my parents will still call me and say, so how's business? And you know, what are you doing these days besides, you know, like your hobby stuff and all that? And the hobby stuff is speaking. Because they don't really think that that's like a real job and, you know, that's what you're doing. But we all in this room and we all speak and we all know that that is what we do. But we don't speak all the time. We're not all the time on the stage. So I could, in the next 45 minutes, speak about how body language speaks on your behalf. How if your presence on stage and off stage, how that can accelerate your business. But I can't. I don't really have the full skill set for that. And I know for a fact there's people in this room that can do a better job than me. I could also speak about presentation and how you could accelerate your business through having better presentations, whether you're using PowerPoint or Prezi or Keynote or any of the many other software that is available to actually accelerate and to really bring a bit of a boost to your presentation. But instead, where I might be a little bit biased because I am a marketing and branding consultant, I want to speak about content. And the word content has almost come up in every single person's presentation that we've had yesterday and today. But I want to look at content from the perspective of how the content you create can accelerate your business. And so I'm roughly going to divide this up into three parts. And the reason why I say roughly three is because I have a very bad habit of chasing rabbits. I think I'm almost professional at chasing rabbits. And I think I got this from, Ziggy's not in the room, but Ziggy's business partner, I was in school with him. So I'm gonna, Ziggy's not in the room, so this is just like between us. It's not being recorded or anything. So I think this guy's a genius. His name is Koen Welch, he's also a professional speaker. He's a psychologist, he's now doing his PhD, and he's doing his MBA at the same time. And he's also trying to write books, and he's also trying to improve his handicap with golf. He literally, I think, is a genius and has, what, in my opinion, a photographic memory. So here I would be in standard 9 and 10 grade, 11 and 12, And the teacher would be writing the, you know, the sums would be on the board, and she X plus Y and whatever else, I'm not paying much attention, and you'll understand why in a moment. She'd be writing that there, and all this time, Kun would be sitting next to me, and he would be chasing rabbits the whole time. And I'm busy there trying to write it out, I'm trying to do the whole thing, and he's just staring at the board, and then continues speaking with me. Which I eventually found out that he probably has a photographic memory, but he got me into this habit of chasing rabbits, and we would chase rabbits all the time, we still do. And I think we stopped counting on one telephone conversation we had recently that we had 27 stories which we never finished in about a 15-minute conversation. And so I chase rabbits like I'm doing now. So I say there's going to be roughly three parts to my presentation. Yeah, it all depends on how deep the rabbit holes go. So in the first part, what I want to look at is that the fact that we live in a content... Do I have to point this? Is the tech failing us again? Ah, there you go. Perfect. So I'm going to, these are the three areas that I want to speak about. I want to speak about the fact that we live in a content era. I want to look at the contents of content. And then I want to look at the content of a salad. Okay. And so when you look at the content era, we live in an era where we literally have a saturation of content. And a lot of people have been doing research and trying to figure out exactly to what extent we are saturated, or when did we become so saturated with content, where right now, in terms of the what is known as the attention economy, where there's physically an economy taking place, where there's shares in your attention, is we're at the point now that if somebody wants your attention, they have to take it away from somebody else. Nobody has spare attention anymore. That's how much content we consume. That's how much content is available. That literally we're at a point in this era of content where there's so much content being produced that you could never consume all the content available. And so in this absolutely just forest of content, how do you stand out as a tree in this forest? Because we are programmed to look for something that is different when there's a whole crowd. So much in the forest, the saying goes, you don't see the tree for the forest. But if there was one tree that was a different color, so if all the trees were green and there was an orange tree, you would see the orange tree. But how do you become that orange tree? How do you as a speaker stand out so much so above everybody else so that you get picked, you're the one that gets chosen to speak at the next conference or for the next big gig, so to speak. So in this content forest that we are in, I believe that we are defined by three things. The content that you create, everybody's creating content. And even if you're not creating content, that essentially is you creating, but you're creating a void, so to speak. That the content you create plus the content you can consume, so everything that you're consuming, whether it's a magazine, a movie, off the radio, off a podcast, off of a virtual training session, or whether it's on Facebook or Twitter or Snapchat or any of the other thousand odd platforms that are out there that you can consume content from. That plus the content which you curate, that defines who you are. We are defined by content. And I would like, and I'm maybe being a little bit biased here because that's the field that I work in, but so and so. Time and time again, I see that people are defined by the content which they create, the content which they consume, the content which they curate. And by curate, I mean, and I also have another problem. So chasing rabbits is one of them. Another one is I alliterate everything. And this started off when I was a youth minister for about 10 years. And I would, every second week, would have to share with the Rio Quite a Lot Youth Ministry. And so there were two of us which would share. And we got into this little competitive thing about who could be the best alliterator. I got up there with, you know, flying colors, and so somebody told me recently I need to stop it, so I'm going to try my best. Right, this is a place where we can practice. Somebody mentioned that this is a safe place. So the content you create, the content you consume, and the content which you share, that defines who you are. And this defines who you are in your personal space, as well as in the public space. And I believe that content doesn't exist in a void. Content is always connected to there's multiple things that content is connected to. But I believe that there's three additional bubbles that bounce into content itself. And I spoke recently about the fact that content reflects who we are, so that defines who we are. But it's not just the content. To get that reflection right, you have to make sure that the content is in context, that there's context. And context speaks about your audience and speaks about the fact that it's relevant to the people that you're presenting the content to. And the next one is that there's cadence. And cadence speaks about, and I'm going to also get away from the alliteration so audience is there. Cadence speaks about the style. And if you have a musical bone in you, or you understand music, or you've had some music class, you understand that cadence is the ups and the downs, the speed, it's the style. And so I'm going to add style in there. And then channel, that content cannot exist without a channel. Now, as speakers, our primary channel is the platform which we stand on, the stage or the carpet which we are on, and that becomes our channel in which we share our content. But that could be Facebook, it could be Twitter, it could be a book that you've written, it could be a blog that you write, or a podcast, a channel. So you can't have content in a bubble. It always is in tension, and it's always bouncing against, and it's always being challenged by the context that it gets shared in, the style that you're going to use, as well as then the channel which you're going to use. And so platforms there. Is it okay? Can I continue with alliteration? It gets a bit annoying to have to do this. Are we good? Anybody really get frustrated with people who alliterate so much?
You don't even know what alliteration
is. Thank you very much. Alliteration is when everything starts with the same letter. Okay, brilliant. So this is like an educational thing. I'm the right person. So the unique content which you create within a specific context, delivered via a channel with your personal cadence, this becomes your personal brand. And this applies to a corporate, this can apply to a one-man business, an SME, can apply to a multinational company, that the content which you create, the way that you present it, so the style that content is delivered, then the platform that is used, the channels which are used, and then obviously the style and the context and how that plays together, that defines who you are. So not only the content which you create and the content which you consume and the content which you share, but it's also in the context that is being shared, and also within the style that you're using. We've been privileged over the last 2 days to see so many different styles and ways of sharing. And that altogether becomes your brand. That defines your brand. That defines who you are. And I want to dare to say that if you remove content out of your presentations here, then we're going to be left with, I wouldn't say inspirational speakers, because that's really nasty, but if you remove content out of what we do as a profession, what do we have? We have nothing. Our business, what we do, what for many of you have stepped out of the corporate world into the speaking world, you've taken that leap with content. You've taken it. I get a lot of youngsters that speak to me and say, well, I want to get into professional speaking, and they're in their early 20s, and I'm saying, you know, it's going to be really hard for you right now to do it, because you don't have a lot of content that you can bring along with you. You need those experiences. I'm not saying that they shouldn't start and they can't get a foot in the door. But understandably, there's a reason why most professional speakers who are at the peak of their game also further on in years. And I need to be very careful there. I'm also starting to get gray hair, but I'm going to blame it on my children. So I want to look at them in the second part of this. So we speak about content, and we often throw out the word content, content, content. You need to create content now. And I get feedback with, well, what kind of content must I create? Well, we've had this whole thing, you need to do virtual presentations, or you need to do podcasts and that. And the whole time I'm thinking, in my back of my mind, I wonder how many people are wondering, what content should I make? What should I be speaking about? Now, it was briefly touched on what kind of things you could do in your podcast, and also when you do your presentations and when you ask questions and stuff, a little bit was given about what can we do, what kind of content can we physically create. And I believe that when you figure out what kind of content you can create and how much content you can create with where you find yourself in your career as a speaker, that's what you can use to accelerate your business. And I'm going to hopefully give you something that you can take away with, regardless of where you are on this path. Now, where this started from, and I have to tell a bit of a story, so I am going to stand on this side. So, I'm an entrepreneur. I've never really officially worked for a boss before. I was in primary school, so this is where the entrepreneurial thing came from. My father always had three jobs and he was always doing entrepreneurial things, so I guess I picked that up at a very young age. I was in primary school, and I figured out that I could undercut the tuck shop with sweets if I took money from children that children gave me money before the time to buy it. Because then what I could do is I could go take their money and go buy sweets at where my father was working. He was a training manager at the Metro Group or the Cashflow Group, and so I knew I could go in and I could get it in bulk, and then I could sell it before break time, and therefore kids wouldn't have to go to the tuck shop, they could get it at a better price. This was an incredibly great business model, until about a week later they threatened to phone my parents, and that was my first business that boomed for a week. That didn't stop me from going. When I went into high school, I had a mini nursery. I was growing flowers and selling that off. So I had all these businesses and went on. So eventually, grade 11, so standard 9, I had an advertising company which I started when I was at school with Kun Walsh. She was my bunny rabbit chasing friend at the time, and now we're business partners too, so to speak. And so I already had a business. So when I got out of school, I didn't have to go and study. I didn't necessarily have to go into the work, force or anything like that. I had my own business, and then we had a family business. I've resigned 3 times from our family business. Anybody ever worked in a family business and realized it's not really something?
Yes? My son has also resigned 3 times.
It's the most awkward thing. It's like, Mom, Dad, I have something important to tell you. And then this is how it happens the first time. And then the second time, it's like, I have to do it again. And the third time, it's like, I hope this is the last time. My dad has sold his company, fortunately, last year, so I don't have to do that ever again. So I always had I always was fortunate enough to not have to work for a boss. I've always been my own boss. And as an entrepreneur, I'm sure you all, if there's anybody here who's an entrepreneur or you're speaking business as your primary business, you realize that you never really go on holiday. Merely what happens is you have a temporarily relocate your office and you might have a better view. Sometimes it's the Bahamas, sometimes it's an island or somewhere nice. That's my office. So in 2011 and 2012, Christmas, New Year's break, I started analyzing tweets. Now at that stage, living in Namibia, my company was the only company who was doing digital marketing within social media. It was something that everybody was like, oh, this is for young people and nobody's going to do it. So all the big ad agencies kind of completely just ignored it, and they said it's going to be a fad, it's never going to, the below the line stuff is never going to overtake the above the line. So I had a bit of an advantage there. And so I started analyzing tweets, and one of the things why I did that, I was working for a motor group, a motor brand group that had 5 different brands under their name. And so what they'd asked me is, what are our competitors doing globally and can we do the same thing locally? So what I said to them is, okay, I'm going to go back during my Christmas holiday and I'm going to analyze tweets. And I analyzed about 400 to 500 tweets. And what I looked at, I was looking at the content, what were they physically sharing? What was in those 100, in those days it was still 180 characters, I'm sorry, 140 characters, what were they actually sharing? So I looked at 10 of the most successful motor vehicle brands on Twitter at the time. You'll be surprised that back in 2011, 2012, not all the motor vehicle brands were on Twitter. Twitter was a touch and go kind of thing at that stage. And there weren't fancy tools that you could use to analyze. You had to kind of do it then, unless you were going to pay large money. There was no budget for this, because I had to do manually. And while I was looking at these 400 to 500 tweets, I realized that most of the tweets could fall into 5 categories. The content was, there were 5 main motivators behind the content that was being shared. And so I found this extremely interesting, and I also have a bit of an interest in anthropology, so I thought, because it started seeming to me that this is the basis of communication. These 5 things represent the basis of communication. So I took some more time and chased many, many rabbits for about 4 months. And after studying a lot, everything from how our ancestors communicated, so from cavemen all the way through to tribes and people groups on different continents, looked at how do people communicate and in a positive way. So what I'm going to deal with is in the positive sense, not in the negative sense, because I don't think negative communication is what we want to be promoting. And so I looked at positive communication, and I found that there were 5 areas, 5 definitive areas that all content that was being created and all content that is shared falls into these five categories. Now, whenever I go and pitch to a client or I do a proposal, I only give them three of the five because I want the competitive advantage, right? So because we're all on an equal playing field here, and I feel like there's the saying that says, you know, a tide rises all ships, I'm going to give you all five. Okay. So the first one is that when we share content because we want to initiate a discussion. So back in our ancestors, when two tribes got together, they would get together and immediately the content that was being shared was shared to spark a conversation. And part of that is that when we share content, when we give a presentation off stage, when we finish our presentation, the content which we've shared should spark a discussion. It should spark a discussion either amongst, if you were sharing with, in the corporate sense, that the employees or whoever's your audience, that they're going to be discussing something or that they want to discuss something with you. But even if you're creating this content on Facebook, on Twitter, Snapchat, in the books that you write, in any online content that you share, there should always be, or your content will fall into, could fall into this category. And I'm going to share all five and then I'm going to show you just how they work together. So it should be, so of the five categories content falls into is a discussion, then there's direction. That's when you look at almost the largest portion of content online is content which gives direction. It's help. It's content which shows somebody something, how to do something. That's why some of the most popular websites are the wiki type websites on WikiHow and these. And if you look at YouTube, some of the most popular videos are tutorial videos. And 5 or 6 years ago, the whole industry of, for example, makeup tutorials and hair tutorials and fashion tutorials on YouTube exploded because direction, people want direction. People want to be given, they want to be helped. They want to be go from point A to point B. And as speakers, that's what we do. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get people, we're giving them direction. We're trying to get them from point A to point B. So the content we share should give direction. Then discovery. I found John's presentation incredibly interesting because of how much discovery elements were in there. You listened, you know, almost every slide there was something new that you could discover. So as speakers, we should be doing that. We should be sharing content that allows people to discover something new. When our ancestors got together, and when we saw hunter-gatherers, not only when they got together, they were saying there's good hunting fields over there. And the other tribe might ask them where's a good place to pick nuts and where's a good place to get mangoes or whatever the case is. There was this sense of saying, give us direction, but also let us discover something new. So the tribe would say, oh, you need to go to that side of the island because there's, they had, maybe hadn't given a name to the fruit, and so they decided to call it pawpaw, for argument's sake. So you want to know that when you are wanting to create content that people want to discuss things, they want to have a better understanding, so they also need to have direction, they need to then also discover new things. And then declaration is something else, is that throughout humanity, as the ages have gone on, different people groups and different tribes and different, and even though some of the tribes that don't exist anymore, leave landmarks behind, leave totem poles, leave those pyramids, leave, what are we going to leave behind? Statue of Liberties and I don't know, Eiffel Towers and so on. But these are declarations. These are things that declare something. Now, often I like to say that if you're into sales, that salespeople like to declare a lot of things. And that's a hard sale. And humanity is, in a sense, when we become proud about something, we want to communicate something. So a lot of the content which we create, we want to declare things. We want to say that we're the best at this, or we've seen this, or we've done this. And Instagram is a platform that has thrived on the fact that people want to show, this is what I had for lunch. That's their declaration. They don't necessarily want feedback or comments, and they might get a like and a little heart or whatever the case is. But we are programmed to declare things. We're programmed to want to, immediately when we've seen something amazing, if you go on a safari or something like that and you see a lion and you know that you're not meant to raise your voice, but the first thing you see, there's a lion! And the lion runs away and nobody else gets to see it. But that's just because it's in our, it's programmed in us to declare things. So when we create content, we need to be declaring things. And yes, back to the whole thing of, that whole thing of being humble, and you're not going to say anything special, and if you've won an award, you're not going to say anything. I don't think that's how we are wired when we create content. And the fifth one, is that when we share, when we create content, we are also, in my mind, we are hardwired for distraction. When John was speaking about the amount of thoughts that we have, and I think it was 50,000, John, something in the room, right? Is John here? No. Is that I think it was 50,000 thoughts that he said, if 50,000 is the number, I wonder what percentage of that is thoughts that are distracting, or how we get distracted. But all of us have been in the situation that if you've been in the corporate world, or you work a 9-to-5, and it's Friday afternoon, and it's 4:30, you don't want an email of somebody wanting to discuss somebody. You don't want somebody knocking on your door wanting to get directions anywhere. You don't want to discover anything new from a new salesperson. You don't want to have to go and speak to the marketing department to declare anything. You want to be distracted. So where do you go? It's Facebook, and it's Twitter, or it's YouTube. So that would be the third, that's the second part of my presentation, is that once you understand that content defines you, that you can use these five categories, that when you create content, that you make sure, and I would like to say that whether it's a 280 character tweet, or it's a long form article on LinkedIn, or even if you are creating videos, or Snapchatting, or Instagram, try to include two or more of these elements in the content you create. If you can create content that sparks discussion, but at the same time allows people to discover something new, then you're hitting the nail on the head. If you can create content that allows people to get direction, but at the same time make that journey for them interesting so that there's a bit of a distraction to it, then you're hitting the nail on the head. And I often work with my clients, and I say to them is that depending on how you want to do your soft and your hard sell, if it's a company that's selling products in retail or so on, is that I divide the content that we create based on that portion of hard to soft sell, and then we'll say the declaration is normally something that's a hard sell, so you can push something like we have this incredible product and give all the stats for it, so that's a bit of a hard declaration push, and we're better than the rest of the industry. You know, if the soft to hard sell is 60-40%, I'll say, you know, make sure that for every six other posts that only four of your posts are declaring something, otherwise your message can get a bit heavy. And in the same ways, you don't want to have every single post a distraction post. Unless you're a comedian, maybe that's justifiable. So when you're creating content, try to include two or more of these five elements. And now I'm going to deconstruct a salad for you, and I'm going to explain how you actually do that. So I had a young gentleman who is an artist, he's a rap artist, and he's into hip-hop, but he also is a blogger. And what he had asked me to do is he wanted me to mentor him a little bit and get him going. And he said that what he actually likes to do is he actually likes to cook. And so his handle is he's French, Angolan, and Namibian. It's a very interesting mix there. And so he likes to cook, but specifically he likes salads. And so he asked me, how do I become the salad guy? I want to be the salad guy. That when people look at me and they see the salad guy. I want to have my Twitter handle as the salad guy. I want to be on Instagram and be the salad guy. And so I said to him, so what are you doing? And he said, well, currently I'm posting pictures of salads I make. I'm like, well, that's interesting. And I said, and what else are you doing? Well, every now and then I post onto my blog, I post the recipe for and how I make the salad. I said to him, well, that doesn't really, not going to make you stand out. You're not going to become the salad guy if that's all that you're doing. Now, if his business was to make salads, you need to replace whichever content, whichever topic that you speak about, or whatever industry you are focused on, replace it for salads just for as an example and as the methodology that we use. Did everybody have salad at lunch? Okay. I do need to go through one or two slides because I do need to clarify something. That's what a salad looks like, right? It's got some mangoes and stuff, and that's also what a salad looks like.
Delicious.
And I'm going to touch on a point because it makes the data seem very interesting, and I'm going to be sharing data so I understand this one. So I needed to explain to this young gentleman is that you're not going to become the salad guy if all you're doing is posting one or two pictures onto Instagram every day about a salad that you've made, you're writing a blog article about salads. It's just not going to cut it. And I have three bars here which are, which indicate salad on Google. If you go and you search for salads on Google, you'll land up with 112 million results in 0.49 seconds. That's how much content Google can find about salad. That is a very big forest to stand out in. So I said to him, if you're just going to do salads, it's not going to cut it. Maybe what we need to look at is salad recipes, because that's what you're doing. And when you look at that, you find out that there's 11,300,000 plus salad recipes. Now, I have to ask, I do cook a lot. I do most of the cooking in the house. I had no idea how you make 11 million salads, right? So I said to him, maybe we need to focus that a little bit more. And let's look at salad dressing. There's 5,100,000 results for salad dressings. And then you go and have lunch, there's always only three, right? There's Thousand Islands, there's Italian, and there's maybe French, and then sometimes they have a vinaigrette. When there's actually, you know, salad dressings, 5.1 million of them. So I said to him is that you're going to have to dig so much deeper into your content if you want to accelerate your business as a salad guy. And I know, Douglas, you shared on this, is that you need to, for every 10 minutes, you need to be able to go at least 3 hours deep into it. I said to him is that if the forest is so big, with so many million pages of content created, you're going to have to go so much deeper. And he said, well, I'm on Instagram, I'm not on Google. So I said, okay, let's have a look at what salads look like on Instagram. 15,900,000 images of salads on Instagram this morning when I checked. That's a lot of salad. And when you look at salad recipes, people that have tagged salad recipes, you get 3.1 million. And when you look at dressings, which is not only for salad dressings, but you still end up having 800,000. That is a lot of images that you have to compete with. So what I landed up sitting with him is I'm saying, let's deconstruct salads. Let's deconstruct the content which you share, which you speak about. And let's see, how can we dig as deep as we can go? How can we get as much content out? And then how can you use that to accelerate your business? And I've probably only got a few minutes left, so I'm going to go through this fairly quickly. Now, I do need to touch on this. The reason why the numbers are a bit skewed, and I do apologize for any Americans in the room, is for some reason, Americans, when you search for images on salad, you get that kind of thing. I'm like, I'm a respectful vegetarian, my whole entire family, extended family are vegetarian, I'm not. So I'm a respectful vegetarian. I look at this and I'm thinking, I could have salads like that every day. So I'm presuming that in American cultures that anything that's not meat and buns equals to salad. So that's where maybe why the results look a bit weird. So let's look at salads. And this could be any industry. You could be speaking about leadership, you could be speaking about HR, about team building, you could speak about various business systems or dynamics or anything, being disruptive or not, technology, HR, AI, throw an acronym in there. You could be speaking about anything, but think of it as a salad. So what if we deconstruct a salad, what do you get? You get ingredients, you get a salad dressing, you're going to get how you prepare that salad, you get presentation. Most people have one salad bowl, right? I look at the ladies in the ladies' book. We have many salad bowls. So in our house, my mother had a salad bowl for potato salad. There was one salad bowl used for carrot salad. If we made green salad, there would be various salad bowls that you could use. And that's all about presentation. Then I said to him, what about pairing? What salads are you going to have with lunch or with a dinner? And what about the health benefits of salad? What about the origins of different salads? Why do we call it an Italian salad or a French salad or a Thousand Islands salad? Where does Thousand Islands come from? And then what about then, back to the thing about recipes. This is how you can deconstruct your themes. Think about every possible element and then think about how can I go and create content on all of those? How can I create a discussion around ingredients? How can I let people discover different dressings? How can I create a distraction video, something that's very interesting? And maybe we can do food pairing. What about main meals and my favorite wine? What wine goes well with a different salad? And then look about the origins, the recipes, but also the ingredients that get used, and then the dressings. So when you look at your content, look at the topic you speak about, and see how can you deconstruct that, and then look at each one and say, of those five categories, how can I create content that will fit into those five categories? And then the big job is deciding what is the style that I'm going to use? I'm going to be more humorous, more technical. I'm going to be more for the layman. I'm going to be use. Is my focus in terms of my audience going to be someone who's new in the industry or someone who's seasoned? And then you think about style. You've got to think about which channels are you using. Are you going to use a blog? Are you going to be on YouTube, Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter? Or are you going to be doing live streaming? Then think about that and then use that. Use that once you've created the content. There's many tools to automate and there's many tools that you can use to allow your content to live online while you are doing what it is that you do that is needed for you to be a speaker. So doing your research and doing your traveling, your logistics and admin. And then once you've created all of this content speaks on your behalf so that you not always have, that your business grows as a result of all this content. Because the saying that I like to say, tell people when it comes to this is that people know you for what they know that you know. Is anybody in this room labeled as the something guy or the something girl? I'm regarded as the social guy in the like. And that means I fix computers and install wireless internet stuff and all of that. But I'm the social media guy. Anybody here has a name as the something guy or something girl?
I'm the ladder girl.
All right.
I'm a performance coach.
You're the performance coach. You are the?
The boom chakalaka girl.
You're the boom chakalaka girl. See, people know you for what they know that you know. And so, in order for you to stand out in a tree of boom chakalakas, you need to be the best at what you do. And people will only know that if you share content and if you can go that depth. Now, on stage, you can't do boom chakalaka for 3 hours. Maybe you can. I don't know. You should be able to. But you might only have 45 minutes to do your keynote. But the content you create needs to show people that you have that depth. And the funny thing is to stand out means you have to have as much depth as possible. The higher you want to stand out, the deeper you need to go. And then you need to create content continually and consistently on that. And with that, I want to just say that there's some recommended reading. I love Content Inc., which is Joe Blasi, who started the Content Institute. And then I heard Gary Vaynerchuk's name thrown around this morning. Incredible stuff, as well as Mark Schaefer, who writes incredible books about content. And so if you want to explore the topic more about how to use content to grow your business, then there's some recommended reading for you. And I'm always open to have a discussion or to do any of those five with you. You can just scan QR code. I do not have business cards. I run a multimedia production company and I don't have business cards. I'm sorry. So thank you very much. Now be sleeping, so I think I did my job.
That's great. Thank you. Yeah, the content part is really important, and like we've already discussed, kind of taking whatever we're creating and finding other ways to reimagine it or maximize it. That might have been a thing of a word. All right, we just had a change of scenery, so Sue Fullergood is going to be in this room. You all good with your? All right. Sue's going to be here, and Rugson is in the other room. So if anybody does want to change, you've got 40 seconds. Okay. All right.